Devil's Ford by Bret Harte. Podcast 1 of 3. Chapter 1. It was a season of unequaled prosperity in Devil's Ford. The half a dozen cabins scattered along the banks of the North Fork, as if by some overflow of that capricious river, had become augmented during a week of fierce excitement by 20 or 30 others, that were huddled together on the narrow gorge of Devil's Spur, or cast up on its steep sides. So sudden and violent had been the change of fortune, that the dwellers in the older cabins had not had time to change with it, but still kept their old habits, customs, and even their old clothes. The flour pan in which their daily bread was mixed stood on the rude table side by side with the prospecting pans, half full of gold washed up from their morning's work. The front windows of the newer tenements looked upon the one single thoroughfare, but the back door opened upon the uncleared wilderness, still haunted by the misshapen bulk of bear or the nightly gliding of catamount. Neither had success as yet affected their boyish simplicity and the frankness of old frontier habits. They played with their newfound riches with the naive delight of children, and rehearsed their glowing future with the importance and triviality of schoolboys. "I've been cock Latin," said Dick Mattingly, leaning on his long-handled shovel with lazy gravity, "that when I go to Rome this winter, I'll get one o' them marble sharps to chisel me a statue o' some kind to set up on the spot where we made our big strike. Suthin' to remember it by, you know." "What kind o' statue, Washington or Webster?" asked one of the Carney brothers, without looking up from his work. "No, I reckon one o' them fancy groups, one o' them Latin goddesses that Fairfax is always gassin' about, sorter leadin', directin' and bossin' us where to dig." "You'd make a healthy lookin' figure in a group," responded Carney, critically regarding an enormous patch in Mattingly's trousers. "Why don't you have a fountain instead?" "Where'll you get the water?" demanded the first speaker, in return. "You know there ain't enough in the North Fork to do a week's washing for the camp, to say nothing of its color."
"Leave that to me," said Carney, with self-possession.
"When I built that there reservoir on Devil's Spur, and bring the water over the ridge from Union Ditch, there'll be enough to spare for that.
Better mix it up, I reckon, have suthin' half statue, half fountain," interposed the elder Mattingly, better known as Maryland Joe, "and set it up afore the town hall and free library I'm cock Latin to give."
"Do that, and you can count on me." After some further discussion, it was gravely settled that Carney should furnish water brought from the Union Ditch, 20 miles away, at a cost of $200,000, to feed a memorial fountain erected by Mattingly, worth $100,000, as a crowning finish to public buildings contributed by Maryland Joe, to the extent of $500,000 more. The disposition of these vast sums by gentlemen wearing patched breeches awakened no sense of the ludicrous, nor did any doubt, reservation, or contingency enter into the plans of the charming enthusiasts themselves. The foundation of their airy castles lay already before them in the strip of rich alluvium on the river bank, where the North Fork, sharply curving round the base of Devil's Spur, had for centuries swept the detritus of gulch and canyon. They had barely crossed the threshold of this treasure house, to find themselves rich men. What possibilities of affluence might be theirs when they had fully exploited their possessions? So confident were they of that ultimate prospect, that the wealth already thus obtained was religiously expended in engines and machinery for the boring of wells and the conveyance of that precious water which the exhausted river had long since ceased to yield. It seemed as if the gold they had taken out was by some ironical compensation gradually making its way back to the soil again through ditch and flume and reservoir. Such was the position of affairs at Devil's Ford on the 13th of August, 1860. It was noon of a hot day. Whatever movement there was in the stifling air was seen rather than felt in a tremulous, quivering, upward-moving dust along the flank of the mountain, through which the spires of the pines were faintly visible. There was no water in the bared and burning bars of the river to reflect the vertical sun, but under its direct rays one or two tinned roofs and corrugated zinc cabins struck fire, a few canvas tents became dazzling to the eye, and the white-wooded corral of the stage office and hotel insupportable. For 2 hours no one ventured in the glare of the open, or even to cross the narrow, unshadowed street, whose dull red dust seemed to glow between the lines of straggling houses.
The heated shells of these green unseasoned tenements gave out a pungent odor of scorching wood and resin. The usual hurried, feverish toil in the claim was suspended, the pick and shovel were left sticking in the richest pay gravel, the toiling millionaires themselves, ragged, dirty, and perspiring, lay panting under the nearest shade, where the pipes went out listlessly, and conversation sank to monosyllables. "There's Fairfax," said Dick Mattingly, at last, with a lazy effort. His face was turned to the hillside, where a man had just emerged from the woods, and was halting irresolutely before the glaring expanse of upheaved gravel and glistening boulders that stretched between him and the shaded group. "He's going to make a break for it," he added, as the stranger, throwing his linen coat over his head, suddenly started into an Indian trot through the pelting sunbeams toward them. This strange act was perfectly understood by the group, who knew that in that intensely dry heat the danger of exposure was lessened by active exercise and the profuse perspiration that followed it. In another moment the stranger had reached their side, dripping as if rained upon, mopping his damp curls and handsome bearded face with his linen coat, as he threw himself pantingly on the ground. "I struck out over here first, boys, to give you a little warning," he said, as soon as he had gained breath. "That engineer will be down here to take charge as soon as the 6 o'clock stage comes in. He's an oldish chap, has got a family of 2 daughters, and I am DD if he is not bringing them down here with him." "Oh, go long," exclaimed the 5 men in one voice, raising themselves on their hands and elbows, and glaring at the speaker. "Fact, boys. Soon as I found it out I just waltzed into that Jew shop at the crossing and bought up all the clothes that would be likely to suit you fellows, before anybody else got a show. I reckon I cleared out the shop. The duds are a little mixed in style, but I reckon they're clean and whole, and a man might face a lady in M. I left them round at the old Buckeye Spring, where they're handy without attracting attention. You boys can go there for a general wash-up, rig yourselves up without saying anything, and then meander back careless and easy in your store clothes, just as the stage is coming in, sabe." "Why didn't you let us know earlier?" asked Mattingly aggrievedly. "You've been back here at least an hour." "I've been getting some place ready for them," returned the newcomer. "We might have managed to put the man somewhere, if he'd been alone, but these women want family accommodation. There was nothing left for me to do but to buy up Thompson's saloon." "No," interrupted his audience, half in incredulity, half in protestation. "Fact. You boys will have to take your drinks under canvas again, I reckon. But I made Thompson let those gold-framed mirrors that used to stand behind the bar go into the bargain, and they sort of furnish the room. You know the saloon is one of them patent houses you can take to pieces, and I've been reckoning you boys will have to pitch in and help me to take the whole shanty over to the laurel bushes, and put it up Agent Kearney's cabin." "What's all that?" said the younger Kearney, with an odd mingling of astonishment and bashful gratification. "Yes, I reckon yours is the cleanest house, because it's the newest, so you'll just step out and let us knock in one o' the gables, and clap it onto the saloon, and make one house of it, don't you see? There'll be 2 rooms, one for the girls and the other for the old man." The astonishment and bewilderment of the party had gradually given way to a boyish and impatient interest. "Hadn't we better do the job at once?" suggested Dick Mattingly. "Or throw ourselves into those new clothes, so as to be ready," added the younger Kearney, looking down at his ragged trousers. "I say, Fairfax, what are the girls like, eh?" All the others had been dying to ask the question, yet one and all laughed at the conscious manner and blushing cheek of the questioner. "You'll find out quick enough," returned Fairfax, whose curt carelessness did not, however, prevent a slight increase of color on his own cheek. "We'd better get that job off our hands before doing anything else. So, if you're ready, boys, we'll just waltz down to Thompson's and pack up the shanty. He's out of it by this time, I reckon. You might as well be perspiring to some purpose over there as gasping under this tree. We won't go back to work this afternoon, but knock off now, and call it half a day. Come. Hump yourselves, gentlemen. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3, and away. In another instant the tree was deserted, the figures of the five millionaires of Devil's Ford, crossing the fierce glare of the open space, with boyish alacrity, glistened in the sunlight, and then disappeared in the nearest fringe of thickets. Chapter 2. 6 hours later, when the shadow of Devil's Spur had crossed the river, and spread a slight coolness over the flat beyond, the pioneer coach, leaving the summit, began also to bathe its heated bulk in the long shadows of the descent. Conspicuous among the dusty passengers, the two pretty and youthful faces of the daughters of Philip Carr, mining superintendent and engineer, looked from the windows with no little anxiety towards their future home in the straggling settlement below, that occasionally came in view at the turns of the long zigzagging road. A slight look of comical disappointment passed between them as they gazed upon the sterile flat, dotted with unsightly excrescences that stood equally for cabins or mounds of stone and gravel. It was so feeble and inconsistent a culmination to the beautiful scenery they had passed through, so hopeless and imbecile a conclusion to the preparation of that long picturesque journey, with its glimpses of sylvan and pastoral glades and canyons, that, as the coach swept down the last incline, and the remorseless monotony of the dead level spread out before them, furrowed by ditches and indented by pits, under cover of shielding their cheeks from the impalpable dust that rose beneath the plunging wheels, they buried their faces in their handkerchiefs, to hide a few half-hysterical tears. Happily, their father, completely absorbed in a practical, scientific, and approving contemplation of the topography and material resources of the scene of his future labors, had no time to notice their defection. It was not until the stage drew up before a rambling tenement bearing the inscription, Hotel and Stage Office, that he became fully aware of it. "We can't stop here, Papa," said Christy Carr decidedly, with a shake of her pretty head. "You can't expect that." Mr. Carr looked up at the building. It was half grocery, half saloon. Whatever other accommodations it contained must have been hidden in the rear, as the flat roof above was almost level with the raftered ceiling of the shop. "Certainly," he replied hurriedly, "we'll see to that in a moment. I dare say it's all right. I told Fairfax we were coming. Somebody ought to be here." "But they're not," said Jesse Carr indignantly, "and the few that were here scampered off like rabbits to their burrows as soon as they saw us get down." It was true. The little group of loungers before the building had suddenly disappeared. There was the flash of a red shirt vanishing in an adjacent doorway, the fading apparition of a pair of high boots and blue overalls in another, the abrupt withdrawal of a curly blonde head from a sashless window over the way. Even the saloon was deserted, although a back door in the dim recess seemed to creak mysteriously. The stagecoach, with the other passengers, had already rattled away. "I certainly think Fairfax understood that," I began Mr. Carr. He was interrupted by the pressure of Christie's fingers on his arm and a subdued exclamation from Jessie, who was staring down the street. "What are they?" she whispered in her sister's ear. "Racial expletive minstrels, a circus, or what?" The five millionaires of Devil's Ford had just turned the corner of the straggling street, and were approaching in single file. One glance was sufficient to show that they had already availed themselves of the new clothing bought by Fairfax, had washed, and one or two had shaved. But the result was startling. Through some fortunate coincidence in size, Dick Mattingly was the only one who had achieved an entire new suit. But it was of funereal black cloth, and although relieved at one extremity by a pair of high riding boots, in which his two short trousers were tucked, and at the other by a tall white hat, and cravat of aggressive yellow, the effect was depressing. In agreeable contrast, his brother, Maryland Joe, was attired in a thin fawn-colored summer overcoat, lightly worn open, so as to show the unstarched bosom of a white embroidered shirt, and a pair of nankeen trousers and pumps. The Carney brothers had divided a suit between them, the elder wearing a tightly fitting, single-breasted blue frock coat and a pair of pink-striped cotton trousers, while the younger candidly displayed the trousers of his brother's suit, as a harmonious change to a shining black alpaca coat and crimson neckerchief. Fairfax, who brought up the rear, had, with characteristic unselfishness, contented himself with a French workman's blue blouse and a pair of white duck trousers. Had they shown the least consciousness of their finery, or of its absurdity, they would have seemed despicable. But only one expression beamed on the five sunburnt and shining faces, a look of unaffected boyish gratification and unrestricted welcome. They halted before Mr. Carr and his daughters, simultaneously removed their various and remarkable head coverings, and waited until Fairfax advanced and severally presented them. Jesse Carr's half-frightened smile took refuge in the trembling shadows of her dark lashes. Christy Carr stiffened slightly, and looked straight before her. "We reckoned that as we intended to meet you and the young ladies at the grade," said Fairfax, reddening a little as he endeavored to conceal his too ready slang, "and save you from trapsing from dragging yourselves up grade again to your house." "Then there is a house," said Jesse, with an alarming frank laugh of relief, that was, however, as frankly reflected in the boyishly appreciative eyes of the young men. "Such as it is," responded Fairfax, with a shade of anxiety, as he glanced at the fresh and pretty costumes of the young women, and dubiously regarded the two Saratoga trunks resting hopelessly on the veranda. "I'm afraid it isn't much, for what you're accustomed to. But," he added more cheerfully, "it will do for a day or two, and perhaps you'll give us the pleasure of showing you the way there now." The procession was quickly formed. Mr. Carr, alive only to the actual business that had brought him there, at once took possession of Fairfax, and began to disclose his plans for the working of the mine, occasionally halting to look at the work already done in the ditches, and to examine the field of his future operations. Fairfax, not displeased at being thus relieved of a lighter attendance on Mr. Carr's daughters, nevertheless from time to time cast a paternal glance backwards upon their escorts, who had each seized a handle of the two trunks, and were carrying them in couples at the young lady's side. The occupation did not offer much freedom for easy gallantry, but no sign of discomfiture or uneasiness was visible in the grateful faces of the young men. The necessity of changing hands at times with their burdens brought a corresponding change of cavalier at the lady's side, although it was observed that the younger Carney, for the sake of continuing a conversation with Miss Jessie, kept his grasp of the handle nearest the young lady until his hand was nearly cut through, and his arm worn out by exhaustion. The only thing on wheels in the camp is a mule wagon, and the mules are packing gravel from the river this afternoon, explained Dick Mattingly apologetically to Christy, "or we'd have carried you and your baggage up to the shanty your house. Give us 2 weeks more, Miss Carr, only 2 weeks to wash up our work and realize, and we'll give you a pair of 2.40 steppers and a skeleton buggy to meet you at the top of the hill and drive you over to the cabin. Perhaps you'd prefer a regular carriage, some ladies do. And a racial expletive driver. But what's the use of planning anything? Afore that time comes we'll have run you up a house on the hill, and you shall pick out the spot. It wouldn't take long unless you preferred brick. I suppose we could get brick over from Lagrange, if you cared for it, but it would take longer. If you could put up for a time with something of stained glass and a mahogany veranda." In spite of her cold indignation, and the fact that she could understand only a part of Mattingly's speech, Christy comprehended enough to make her lift her clear eyes to the speaker, as she replied freezingly that she feared she would not trouble them long with her company. "Oh, you'll get over that," responded Mattingly, with an exasperating confidence that drove her nearly frantic, from the manifest kindliness of intent that made it impossible for her to resent it. "I felt that way myself at first. Things will look strange and unsociable for a while, until you get the hang of them. You'll naturally stamp round and cuss a little." He stopped in conscious consternation. With ready tact, and before Christy could reply, Maryland Joe had put down the trunk and changed hands with his brother. "You mustn't mind Dick, or he'll go off and kill himself with shame," he whispered laughingly in her ear. "He means all right, but he's picked up so much slang here that he's about forgotten how to talk English, and it's nigh on to 4 years since he's met a young lady." Christy did not reply. yet the laughter of her sister in advance with the Carney brothers seemed to make the reserve with which she tried to crush further familiarity only ridiculous. "Do you know many operas, Miss Carr?" She looked at the boyish, interested, sunburnt face so near to her own, and hesitated. After all, why should she add to her other real disappointments by taking this absurd creature seriously? "In what way?" she returned, with a half-smile. "To play. On the piano, of course. There isn't one nearer here than Sacramento, but I reckon we could get a small one by Thursday. You couldn't do anything on a banjo," he added doubtfully, "Kearney's got one. I imagine it would be very difficult to carry a piano over those mountains," said Christie laughingly, "to avoid the collateral of the banjo. We got a billiard table over from Stockton," half bashfully interrupted Dick Mattingly, struggling from his end of the trunk to recover his composure, "and it had to be brought over in sections on the back of a mule, so I don't see why." He stopped short again in confusion, at a sign from his brother, and then added, "I mean, of course, that a piano is a heap more delicate and valuable and all that sort of thing, but it's worth trying for. Fairfax was always saying he'd get one for himself, so I reckon it's possible," said Joe. "Does he play?" asked Christie. "You bet," said Joe, quite forgetting himself in his enthusiasm. "He can snatch Mozart and Beethoven bald-headed." In the embarrassing silence that followed this speech, the fringe of pinewood nearest the flat was reached. Here there was a rude clearing, and beneath an enormous pine stood the two recently joined tenements. There was no attempt to conceal the point of junction between Kearney's cabin and the newly transported saloon from the flat, no architectural illusion of the palpable collusion of the two buildings, which seemed to be telescoped into each other. The front room or living room occupied the whole of Kearney's cabin. It contained, in addition to the necessary articles for housekeeping, a bunk or berth for Mr. Carr, so as to leave the second building entirely to the occupation of his daughters as bedroom and boudoir. There was a half-humorous, half-apologetic exhibition of the rude utensils of the living room, and then the young men turned away as the two girls entered the open door of the second room. Neither Christie nor Jessie could for a moment understand the delicacy which kept these young men from accompanying them into the room they had but a few moments before decorated and arranged with their own hands, and it was not until they turned to thank their strange entertainers that they found that they were gone. The arrangement of the second room was rude and bizarre, but not without a singular originality and even tastefulness of conception. What had been the counter or bar of the saloon, gorgeous in white and gold, now sawn in two and divided, was set up on opposite sides of the room as separate dressing tables, decorated with huge bunches of azaleas, that hid the rough earthenware bowls, and gave each table the appearance of a vestal altar. The huge gilt-plate glass mirror which had hung behind the bar still occupied one side of the room, but its length was artfully divided by an enormous rosette of red, white, and blue muslin, one of the surviving 4th of July decorations of Thompson's saloon. On either side of the door, two pathetic-looking, convent-like cots, covered with spotless sheeting, and heaped up in the middle, like a snow-covered grave, had attracted their attention. They were still staring at them when Mr. Carr anticipated their curiosity. "I ought to tell you that the young men confided to me the fact that there was neither bed nor mattress to be had on the ford. They have filled some flour sacks with clean dry moss from the woods, and put half a dozen blankets on the top, and they hope you can get along until the messenger who starts tonight for Lagrange can bring some bedding over." Jessie flew with mischievous delight to satisfy herself of the truth of this marvel. "It's so, Christie," she said laughingly, "three flour sacks apiece, but I'm jealous, yours are all marked superfine, and mine middlings." Mr. Carr had remained uneasily watching Christie's shadowed face. "What matters?" she said drily. "The accommodation is all in keeping. It will be better in a day or two," he continued, casting a longing look towards the door, the first refuge of masculine weakness in an impending domestic emergency. "I'll go and see what can be done," he said feebly, with a sidelong impulse towards the opening and freedom. "I've got to see Fairfax again tonight anyway." "One moment, Father," said Christie, wearily. Did you know anything of this place and these people before you came?
Certainly, of course I did, he returned, with the sudden testiness of disturbed abstraction.
What are you thinking of?
I knew the geological strata and the report of Fairfax and his partners before I consented to take charge of the works. And I can tell you that there is a fortune here. I intend to make my own terms, and share in it.
And not take a salary or some sum of money down, said Christie, slowly removing her bonnet in the same resigned way.
I am not a hired man, or a workman, Christie, said her father sharply.
You ought not to oblige me to remind you of that.
But the hired men, the superintendent and his workmen, were the only ones who ever got anything out of your last experience with Colonel Waters at Lagrange, and we at least lived among civilized people there.
These young men are not common people, Christie, even if they have forgotten the restraints of speech and manners, they're gentlemen.
Who are willing to live like Negroes.
You can make them what you please.
Christie raised her eyes.
There was a certain cynical ring in her father's voice that was unlike his usual hesitating abstraction.
It both puzzled and pained her.
I mean, he said hastily, that you have the same opportunity to direct the lives of these young men into more regular, disciplined channels that I have to regulate and correct their foolish waste of industry and material here.
It would at least beguile the time for you.
Fortunately for Mr. Carr's escape and Christie's uneasiness, Jesse, who had been examining the details of the living room, broke in upon this conversation.
I'm sure it will be as good as a perpetual picnic.
George Carney says we can have a cooking stove under the tree outside at the back, and as there will be no rain for 3 months we can do the cooking there, and that will give us more room for the piano when it comes, and there's an old squaw to do the cleaning and washing up any day and it will be real fun.
She stopped breathlessly, with glowing cheeks and sparkling eyes, a charming picture of youth and trustfulness.
Mr. Carr had seized the opportunity to escape.
Really, now, Christie, said Jesse confidentially, when they were alone, and Christie had begun to unpack her trunk, and to mechanically put her things away, they're not so bad.
Who? Asked Christie.
Why, the Carneys, and Mattingleys, and Fairfax, and the lot, provided you don't look at their clothes.
And think of it.
They told me, for they tell one everything in the most alarming way, that those clothes were bought to please us.
A scramble of things bought at Lagrange, without reference to size or style.
And to hear these creatures talk, why, you'd think they were Astors or Rothschilds.
Think of that little one with the curls. I don't believe he is over 17, for all his baby mustache says he's going to build an assembly hall for us to give a dance in next month, and apologizes the next breath to tell us that there isn't any milk to be had nearer than Lagrange, and we must do without it, and use syrup in our tea tomorrow.
And where is all this wealth? Said Christie, forcing herself to smile at her sister's animation.
Under our very feet, my child, and all along the river.
Why, what we thought was pure and simple mud is what they call gold-bearing cement.
I suppose that is why they don't brush their boots and trousers, it's so precious, returned Christie drily.
And have they ever translated this precious dirt into actual coin?
Bless you, yes.
Why, that dirty little gutter, you know, that ran along the side of the road and followed us down the hill all the way here, that cost them, let me see, yes, nearly $60,000.
And fancy.
Papa's just condemned it, says it won't do, and they've got to build another.
An impatient sigh from Christie drew Jessie's attention to her troubled eyebrows.
Don't worry about our disappointment, dear.
It isn't so very great.
I dare say we'll be able to get along here in some way, until Papa is rich again.
You know they intend to make him share with them.
It strikes me that he is sharing with them already, said Christie, glancing bitterly round the cabin, sharing everything ourselves, our lives, our tastes.
Yes, said Jesse, with vaguely hesitating assent.
Yes, even these, she showed two dice in the palm of her little hand.
I found them in the drawer of our dressing table.
Throw them away, said Christie impatiently. but Jesse's small fingers closed over the dice. "I'll give them to the little carny. I dare say they were the poor boy's playthings." The appearance of these relics of wild dissipation, however, had lifted Christie out of her sublime resignation. "For heaven's sake, Jesse," she said, "look around and see if there is anything more." To make sure, they each began to scrimmage, the broken-spirited Christie exhibiting both alacrity and penetration in searching obscure corners. In the dining room, behind the dresser, three or four books were discovered, an odd volume of Thackeray, another of Dickens, a memorandum book or diary. "This seems to be Latin," said Jesse, fishing out a smaller book.
"I can't read it."
"It's just as well you shouldn't," said Christie shortly, whose ideas of a general classical impropriety had been gathered from pages of Lempriere's dictionary. "Put it back directly." Jesse returned certain odes of one Horatius Flaccus to the corner, and uttered an exclamation. "Oh, Christie, here are some letters tied up with a ribbon." They were two or three prettily written letters, exhaling a faint odor of refinement and of the pressed flowers that peeped from between the loose leaves.
"I see, my darling Fairfax. It's from some woman. I don't think much of her, whosoever she is," said Christie, tossing the intact packet back into the corner.
"Nor I," echoed Jesse. Nevertheless, by some feminine inconsistency, evidently the circumstance did make them think more of him, for a minute later, when they had re-entered their own room, Christie remarked, "The idea of petting a man by his family name. Think of Mama ever having called Papa Darling Carr."
"Oh, but his family name isn't Fairfax," said Jesse hastily, "that's his first name, his Christian name. I forget what's his other name, but nobody ever calls him by it."
"Do you mean," said Christie, with glistening eyes and awful deliberation, "do you mean to say that we're expected to fall in with this insufferable familiarity? I suppose they'll be calling us by our Christian names next."
"Oh, but they do," said Jesse, mischievously.
"What?"
"They call me Miss Jesse, and Carney, the little one, asked me if Christie played."
"And what did you say?"
"I said that you did," answered Jesse, with an affectation of cherubic simplicity.
"You do, dear, don't you? There, don't get angry, darling, I couldn't flare up all of a sudden in the face of that poor little creature, he looked so absurd and so honest." Christie turned away, relapsing into her old resigned manner, and assuming her household duties in a quiet, temporizing way that was, however, without hope or expectation. Mr. Carr, who had dined with his friends under the excuse of not adding to the awkwardness of the first day's housekeeping, returned late at night with a mass of papers and drawings, into which he afterwards withdrew, but not until he had delivered himself of a mysterious package entrusted to him by the young men for his daughters. It contained a contribution to their board in the shape of a silver spoon and battered silver mug, which Jesse chose to facetiously consider as an affecting reminiscence of the youthful Kearney's christening days, which it probably was. The young girls retired early to their white snowdrifts, Jesse not without some hilarious struggles with hers, in which she was, however, quickly surprised by the deep and refreshing sleep of youth, Christie to lie awake and listen to the night wind, that had changed from the first cool whispers of sunset to the sturdy breath of the mountain. At times the frail house shook and trembled. Wandering gusts laden with the deep rosy noose odors of the wood found their way through the imperfect jointure of the two cabins, swept her cheek and even stirred her long, wide-open lashes. A broken spray of pine needles rustled along the roof, or a pine cone dropped with a quick reverberating tap-tap that for an instant startled her. Lying thus, wide awake, she fell into a dreamy reminiscence of the past, hearing snatches of old melody in the moving pines, fragments of sentences, old words, and familiar epithets in the murmuring wind at her ear, and even the faint breath of long-forgotten kisses on her cheek. She remembered her mother, a pallid creature, who had slowly faded out of one of her father's vague speculations in a vaguer speculation of her own, beyond his ken, whose place she had promised to take at her father's side. The words, "Watch over him, Christie, he needs a woman's care,"
again echoed in her ears, as if borne on the night wind from the lonely grave in the lonelier cemetery by the distant sea. She had devoted herself to him with some little sacrifices of self, only remembered now for their uselessness in saving her father the disappointment that sprang from his sanguine and one-ideaed temperament. She thought of him lying asleep in the other room, ready on the morrow to devote those fateful qualities to the new enterprise that with equally fateful disposition she believed would end in failure. It did not occur to her that the doubts of her own practical nature were almost as dangerous and illogical as his enthusiasm, and that for that reason she was fast losing what little influence she possessed over him. With the example of her mother's weakness before her eyes, she had become an unsparing and distrustful critic, with the sole effect of awakening his distrust and withdrawing his confidence from her. He was beginning to deceive her as he had never deceived her mother. Even Jessie knew more of this last enterprise than she did herself. All that did not tend to decrease her utter restlessness. It was already past midnight when she noticed that the wind had again abated. The mountain breeze had by this time possessed the stifling valleys and heated bars of the river in its strong, cold embraces, the equilibrium of nature was restored, and a shadowy mist rose from the hollow. A stillness, more oppressive and intolerable than the previous commotion, began to pervade the house and the surrounding woods. She could hear the regular breathing of the sleepers. She even fancied she could detect the faint impulses of the more distant life in the settlement. The far-off barking of a dog, a lost shout, the indistinct murmur of some nearer watercourse, mere phantoms of sound made the silence more irritating. With a sudden resolution she arose, dressed herself quietly and completely, threw a heavy cloak over her head and shoulders, and opened the door between the living room and her own. Her father was sleeping soundly in his bunk in the corner. She passed noiselessly through the room, opened the lightly fastened door, and stepped out into the night. In the irritation and disgust of her walk hither, she had never noticed the situation of the cabin, as it nestled on the slope at the fringe of the woods. In the preoccupation of her disappointment and the mechanical putting away of her things, she had never looked once from the window of her room, or glanced backward out of the door that she had entered. The view before her was a revelation, a reproach, a surprise that took away her breath. Over her shoulders the newly risen moon poured a flood of silvery light, stretching from her feet across the shining bars of the river to the opposite bank, and on up to the very crest of the Devil's Spur, no longer a huge bulk of crushing shadow, but the steady exaltation of plateau, spur, and terrace clothed with replete and unutterable beauty. In this magical light that beauty seemed to be sustained and carried along by the river winding at its base, lifted again to the broad shoulder of the mountain, and lost only in the distant vista of death-like, overcrowning snow. Behind and above where she stood the towering wood seemed to be waiting with opened ranks to absorb her with the little cabin she had quitted, dwarfed into insignificance in the vast prospect, but nowhere was there another sign or indication of human life and habitation. She looked in vain for the settlement, for the rugged ditches, the scattered cabins, and the unsightly heaps of gravel. In the glamour of the moonlight they had vanished, a veil of silver-gray vapor touched here and there with ebony shadows masked its sight. A black strip beyond was the river bank. All else was changed. With a sudden sense of awe and loneliness she turned to the cabin and its sleeping inmates, all that seemed left to her in the vast and stupendous domination of rock and wood and sky. But in another moment the loneliness passed. A new and delicious sense of an infinite hospitality and friendliness in their silent presence began to possess her. This same slighted, forgotten, uncomprehended, but still foolish and forgiving nature seemed to be bending over her frightened and listening ear with vague but thrilling murmurings of freedom and independence. She felt her heart expand with its wholesome breath, her soul fill with its sustaining truth. She felt. What was that? An unmistakable outburst of a drunken song at the foot of the slope. Oh, my name it is Johnny from Pike. I'm HLL on a spree or a strike. She stopped as crimson with shame and indignation as if the viewless singer had risen before her. I knew when to bet, and get up and get. Hush. D.N. it all. Don't you hear? There was the sound of hurried whispers, a no and yes, and then a dead silence.
Christie crept nearer to the edge of the slope in the shadow of a buckeye. In the clearer view she could distinguish a staggering figure in the trail below who had evidently been stopped by two other expostulating shadows that were approaching from the shelter of a tree.
Show,
didn't know. The staggering figure endeavored to straighten itself, and then slouched away in the direction of the settlement. The two mysterious shadows retreated again to the tree, and were lost in its deeper shadow. Christie darted back to the cabin, and softly re-entered her room. I thought I heard a noise that woke me, and I missed you, said Jessie, rubbing her eyes. Did you see anything?
No,
said Christie, beginning to undress. You weren't frightened, dear. Not in the least, said Christie, with a strange little laugh. Go to sleep. Chapter 3. The five impulsive millionaires of Devil's Ford fulfilled not a few of their most extravagant promises. In less than 6 weeks Mr. Carr and his daughters were installed in a new house, built near the site of the double cabin, which was again transferred to the settlement, in order to give greater seclusion to the fair guests. It was a long, roomy, one-storied villa, with a not unpicturesque combination of deep veranda and trellis work, which relieved the flat monotony of the interior and the barrenness of the freshly cleared ground. An upright piano, brought from Sacramento, occupied the corner of the parlor. A suite of gorgeous furniture, whose pronounced and extravagant glories the young girls instinctively hid under homemade linen covers, had also been spoils from afar. Elsewhere the house was filled with ornaments and decorations that in their incongruity forcibly recalled the gilded plate glass mirrors of the bedroom in the old cabin. In the hasty furnishing of this Aladdin's palace, the slaves of the ring had evidently seized upon anything that would add to its glory, without reference always to fitness. I wish it didn't look so cussedly like a robber's cave, said George Carney, when they were taking a quiet preliminary survey of the unclassified treasures, before the cars took possession. Or a gambling hell, said his brother reflectively. It's about the same thing, I reckon, said Dick Mattingly, who was supposed, in his fiery youth, to have encountered the similarity. Nevertheless, the two girls managed to bestow the heterogeneous collection with tasteful adaptation to their needs. A crystal chandelier, which had once lent a fascinating illusion to the game of Monte, hung unlighted in the broad hall, where a few other bizarre and public articles were relegated. A long red sofa or bench, which had done duty beside a billiard table, found a place here also. Indeed, it is to be feared that some of the more rustic and bashful youths of Devil's Ford, who had felt it incumbent upon them to pay their respects to the newcomers, were more at ease in this vestibule than in the arcana beyond, whose glories they could see through the open door. To others, it represented a recognized state of probation before their re-entree into civilization again. I reckon, if you don't mind, miss, said the spokesman of one party, easy this is our first call, we'll sorter hang out in the hall here, until you are used to us. On another occasion, one Whiskey Dick, impelled by a sense of duty, paid a visit to the new house and its fair occupants, in a fashion frankly recounted by him afterwards at the bar of the Tecumseh Saloon. You see, boys, I dropped in there the other night, when some of you fellers was doing the high-toned thankee, marm business in the parlor. I just came to anchor in the corner of the sofy in the hall, without letting on to say that I was there, and took up a Webster's dictionary that was on the table and laid it open careless-like, on my knees, easy if I was sorter consulting it and kinder dozed off there, listening to you fellows gassin' with the young ladies, and that your Miss Christie just snakin' music outer that pianner, and I reckon I fell asleep. Anyhow, I was there nigh on to 2 hours. It's mighty soothin', them fashionable calls, sorter knocks the old camp dust outer a fellow, and sets him up again. It would have been well if the new life of the Devil's Ford had shown no other irregularity than the harmless eccentricities of its original locators. But the news of its sudden fortune, magnified by report, began presently to flood the settlement with another class of adventurers. A tide of waifs, strays, and malcontents of old camps along the river began to set towards Devil's Ford, in very much the same fashion as the debris, drift,
and alluvium had been carried down in bygone days and cast upon its banks. A few immigrant wagons, diverted from the highways of travel by the fame of the new diggings, halted upon the slopes of Devil's Spur and on the arid flats of the ford, and disgorged their sallow freight of alkali-poisoned, prematurely aged women and children and maimed and fever-stricken men. Against this rude form of domesticity were opposed the chromo-tinted dresses and extravagant complexions of a few single unattended women happily seen more often at night behind gilded bars than in the garish light of day and an equal number of pale-faced, dark-mustached, well-dressed, and suspiciously idle men. A dozen rivals of Thompson's saloon had sprung up along the narrow main street. There were two new hotels, one a temperance house, whose ascetic quality was confined only to the abnegation of whiskey arrival stage office, and a small one-storied building, from which the Sierran banner fluttered weekly, for $10 a year, in advance. Insufferable in the glare of a Sabbath sun, bleak, windy, and flaring in the gloom of a Sabbath night, and hopelessly depressing on all days of the week, the First Presbyterian Church lifted its blunt steeple from the barrenest area of the flats, and was hideous. The civic improvements so enthusiastically contemplated by the five millionaires in the earlier pages of this voracious chronicle, the fountain, reservoir, town hall, and free library had not yet been erected. Their sites had been anticipated by more urgent buildings and mining works, unfortunately not considered in the sanguine dreams of the enthusiasts, and, more significant still, their cost and expense had been also anticipated by the enormous outlay of their earnings in the work upon Devil's Ditch. Nevertheless, the liberal fulfillment of their promise in the new house in the suburbs blinded the young girl's eyes to their shortcomings in the town. Their own remoteness and elevation above its feverish life kept them from the knowledge of much that was strange, and perhaps disturbing to their equanimity. As they did not mix with the immigrant women, Miss Jessie's good-natured intrusion into one of their half-nomadic camps one day having been met with rudeness and suspicion, they gradually fell into the way of trusting the responsibility of new acquaintances to the hands of their original hosts, and of consulting them in the matter of local recreation. It thus occurred that one day the two girls, on their way to the main street for an hour's shopping at the Villa de Paris and Variety Store, were stopped by Dick Mattingly a few yards from their house, with the remark that, as the county election was then in progress, it would be advisable for them to defer their intention for a few hours. As he did not deem it necessary to add that two citizens, in the exercise of a freeman's franchise, had been supplementing their ballots with bullets, in front of an admiring crowd, they knew nothing of that accident that removed from Devil's Ford an entertaining stranger, who had only the night before partaken of their hospitality. A week or two later, returning one morning from a stroll in the forest, Christie and Jessie were waylaid by George Carney and Fairfax, and, under pretext of being shown a new and romantic trail, were diverted from the regular path. This enabled Mattingly and Maryland Joe to cut down the body of a man hanged by the Vigilance Committee a few hours before on the regular trail, and to remonstrate with the committee on the incompatibility of such exhibitions with a maidenly worship of nature. With the whole county to hang a man in, expostulated Joe, you might keep clear of Carr's Woods. It is needless to add that the young girls never knew of this act of violence, or the delicacy that kept them in ignorance of it. Mr. Carr was too absorbed in business to give heed to what he looked upon as a convulsion of society as natural as a geological upheaval, and too prudent to provoke the criticism of his daughters by comment in their presence. An equally unexpected confidence, however, took its place. Mr. Carr, having finished his coffee one morning, lingered a moment over his perfunctory paternal embraces, with the awkwardness of a preoccupied man endeavoring by the assumption of a lighter interest to veil another abstraction. "And what are we doing today, Christie?" he asked, as Jessie left the dining room. "Oh, pretty much the usual thing, nothing in particular. If George Carney gets the horses from the summit, we're going to ride over to Indian Spring to picnic. Fairfax, Mr. Monroe, I always forget that man's real name in this dreadfully familiar country. Well, he's coming to escort us, and take me, I suppose, that is, if Carney takes Jessie." "A very nice arrangement," returned her father, with a slight nervous contraction of the corners of his mouth and eyelids to indicate mischievousness.
I've no doubt they'll both be here. You know they usually are, ha?
Ha?
And what about the two Mattinglys and Philip Kearney, eh? He continued, won't they be jealous?
It isn't their turn, said Christie carelessly. Besides, they'll probably be there.
And I suppose they're beginning to be resigned, said Carr, smiling.
What on earth are you talking of, father?
She turned her clear brown eyes upon him, and was regarding him with such manifest unconsciousness of the drift of his speech, and, withal, a little vague impatience of his archness, that Mr. Carr was feebly alarmed. It had the effect of banishing his assumed playfulness, which made his serious explanation the more irritating.
Well, I rather thought that young Kearney was paying considerable attention to Jessie, replied her father, with hesitating gravity.
What, that boy? Young Kearney is one of the original locators, and an equal partner in the mine.
A very enterprising young fellow.
In fact, much more advanced and bolder in his conceptions than the others.
I find no difficulty with him.
At another time Christie would have questioned the convincing quality of this proof, but she was too much shocked at her father's first suggestion, to think of anything else.
You don't mean to say, father, that you are talking seriously of these men, your friends whom we see every day and are only company?
No, no, said Mr. Carr hastily, you misunderstand. I don't suppose that Jessie or you.
Or me.
Am I included?
You don't let me speak, Christie.
I mean, I am not talking seriously, continued Mr. Carr, with his most serious aspect, of you and Jessie in this matter, but it may be a serious thing to these young men to be thrown continually in the company of two attractive girls.
I understand you mean that we should not see so much of them, said Christie, with a frank expression of relief so genuine as to utterly discompose her father.
Perhaps you are right, though I fail to discover anything serious in the attentions of young Kearney to Jessie or whoever it may be to me.
But it will be very easy to remedy it, and see less of them.
Indeed, we might begin today with some excuse.
Yes, certainly.
Of course, said Mr. Carr, fully convinced of his utter failure, but, like most weak creatures, consoling himself with the reflection that he had not shown his hand or committed himself.
Yes, but it would perhaps be just as well for the present to let things go on as they were.
We'll talk of it again, I'm in a hurry now, and, edging himself through the door, he slipped away.
What do you think is father's last idea? Said Christie, with, I fear, a slight lack of reverence in her tone, as her sister re-entered the room.
He thinks George Kearney is paying you too much attention.
No, said Jessie, replying to her sister's half-interrogative, half-amused glance with a frank, unconscious smile.
Yes, and he says that Fairfax, I think it's Fairfax, is equally fascinated with me.
Jessie's brow slightly contracted as she looked curiously at her sister.
Of all things, she said, I wonder if anyone has put that idea into his dear old head.
He couldn't have thought it himself.
I don't know, said Christie musingly, but perhaps it's just as well if we kept a little more to ourselves for a while.
Did father say so? Said Jessie quickly.
No, but that is evidently what he meant.
Yes, said Jessie slowly, unless.
Unless what? Said Christie sharply.
Jessie, you don't for a moment mean to say that you could possibly conceive of anything else.
I mean to say, said Jessie, stealing her arm around her sister's waist demurely, that you are perfectly right.
We'll keep away from these fascinating devil's forders, and particularly the youngest Kearney.
I believe there has been some ill-natured gossip.
I remember that the other day, when we passed the shanty of that Pike County family on the slope, there were three women at the door, and one of them said something that made poor little Kearney turn white and pink alternately, and dance with suppressed rage.
I suppose the old Lady M. Corkle, that's her name, would like to have a share of our cavaliers for her Euphemie and Mamie.
I dare say it's only right, I would lend them the Cherub occasionally, and you might let them have Mr. Monroe twice a week.
She laughed, but her eyes sought her sister's with a certain watchfulness of expression.
Christie shrugged her shoulders, with a suggestion of disgust.
Don't joke. We ought to have thought of all this before. But when we first knew them, in the dear old cabin, there wasn't any other woman and nobody to gossip, and that's what made it so nice.
I don't think so very much of civilization, do you? Said the young lady pertly.
Christie did not reply.
Perhaps she was thinking the same thing. It certainly had been very pleasant to enjoy the spontaneous and chivalrous homage of these men, with no further suggestion of recompense or responsibility than the permission to be worshipped, but beyond that she racked her brain in vain to recall any look or act that proclaimed the lover. These men, whom she had found so relapsed into barbarism that they had forgotten the most ordinary forms of civilization, these men, even in whose extravagant admiration there was a certain loss of self-respect, that as a woman she would never forgive, these men, who seemed to belong to another race impossible. Yet it was so. What construction must they have put upon her father's acceptance of their presence, of their company, of her freedom in their presence? No. They must have understood from the beginning that she and her sister had never looked upon them except as transient hosts and chance acquaintances. Any other idea was preposterous. And yet, it was the recurrence of this yet that alarmed her. For she remembered now that but for their slavish devotion they might claim to be her equal. According to her father's account, they had come from homes as good as their own, they were certainly more than her equal in fortune, and her father had come to them as an employee, until they had taken him into partnership. If there had only been sentiment of any kind connected with any of them. But they were all alike, brave, unselfish, humorous and often ridiculous. If anything, Dick Mattingly was funniest by nature, and made her laugh more. Maryland Joe, his brother, told better stories, sometimes of Dick, though not so good a mimic as the other Carney, who had a fairly sympathetic voice in singing. They were all good-looking enough, perhaps they set store on that men are so vain. And as for her own rejected suitor, Fairfax Monroe, except for a kind of grave and proper motherliness about his protecting manner, he absolutely was the most indistinctive of them all. He had once brought her some rare tea from the Chinese camp, and had taught her how to make it, he had cautioned her against sitting under the trees at nightfall, he had once taken off his coat to wrap around her. Really, if this were the only evidence of devotion that could be shown, she was safe.
Well, said Jessie, it amuses you, I see.
Christie checked the smile that had been dimpling the cheek nearest Jessie, and turned upon her the face of an elder sister.
Tell me, have you noticed this extraordinary attention of Mr. Monroe to me?
Candidly, asked Jessie, seating herself comfortably on the table sideways, and endeavoring, to pull her skirt over her little feet.
Honest Injun.
Don't be idiotic, and, above all, don't be slangy.
Of course, candidly.
Well, no. I can't say that I have.
Then, said Christie, why in the name of all that's preposterous, do they persist in pairing me off with the least interesting man of the lot?
Jessie leaped from the table.
Come now, she said, with a little nervous laugh, he's not so bad as all that.
You don't know him.
But what does it matter now, as long as we're not going to see them anymore?
They're coming here for the ride today, said Christie resignedly.
Father thought it better not to break it off at once.
Father thought so, echoed Jessie, stopping with her hand on the door.
Yes, why do you ask?
But Jessie had already left the room, and was singing in the hall.